Hi, I'm Miley Oye. I work at Google as a developer programs tech lead. This video is one of several in our checklist for mobile site improvement. I decided to make these videos in Q4 of 2013 because I found the mobile web's inefficiencies fairly disheartening. To improve matters, in this video, we'll go beyond the basics of stop frustrating your customers and proactively work to optimize the top mobile tasks on your site. An interesting idea I learned about mobile users is that just by holding a mobile device, their expectation of time can differ from their desktop attitude. While as site owners, we're well aware of mobile network latency and that at its fastest, mobile can't outperform desktop, Strange Loop cites that 85% of mobile users expect sites to load at least as fast or faster than sites on desktop. And when it comes to shopping, mobile users seem almost eager to close the deal. 55% of consumers using mobile to research want to purchase within the hour. 83% want to purchase within a day. And that's exactly why we should discuss optimizing the top mobile tasks on your site. Helpful prerequisites for this video include web analytics. I'll be using Google Analytics, as well as Webmaster Tools' verified ownership of your mobile site. If you publish mobile content on a separate URL from desktop, such as on a subdomain, be sure the m.site is verified. To optimize mobile task completion, we first need to gain insight to mobile user intent. Then, with this knowledge, refine our mobile metrics. And last, improve user workflow. We'll begin with gaining insight to mobile user intent. Rather than dive right in, let's take a step back and discuss mobile intent more generally. In Usability of Mobile Websites, under What to Include on a Mobile Site, are tasks that relate to users avoiding a deadline, checking rapidly changing information, viewing private information. This is probably because mobile phones are much more personal than tablets or laptops. The other tasks mentioned for mobile sites are obtaining business information like phone number or store hours, finding directions, and communicating, such as with email or social networking sites. Many of these tasks probably resonate with your own smartphone usage. Still thinking high level, another way to understand mobile user intent is through search queries. Behind each keyword, there's a task a user was trying to complete. It may be useful to slice, dice, and categorize your search queries to provide more lenses for viewing your data. Informational queries show intent for the searcher to learn or research something. Transactional queries reflect the searcher wanting to perform an activity, such as buying a product or downloading a file. Navigational queries are when a searcher wants to go to a specific page. Commonly, businesses also include categories of branded and non-branded keywords, as well as queries with local or geo intent. To make things more concrete and to dive deeper into the data, I'll reference the e-commerce site, the Google Store, at www.googlestore.com in many of my examples. As for the data, let's begin in Google Analytics and create a mobile traffic segment. Start with Create New Segment. Then select the mobile traffic preset. In Visitors Flow, we can see how mobile users travel through our site. For the Google Store, it appears that from our homepage, about 12% continue to the main shopping page at /shop.axd/home, while over 50% drop off. Although we still need to focus on understanding the mobile user intent, questions in the back of my mind at this point are why the 50% drop-off, and is the homepage useful? Additionally, we notice that users like to site search. To better understand mobile intent, what are visitors searching for? To answer this question, Analytics has a site search, search terms feature. Visitors to the Google Store show intent to see shirts, YouTube merchandise, and also the Google Store's phone number. Let's make a note of these top queries. Given that site search shows thousands of attempts in the last few months, questions we start asking are, should we consider making on-site search terms more findable in the navigation? Can we autocomplete popular query terms or send searchers directly to the right page rather than a list of results? Are the search results even relevant? It's also fun to look at in-page analysis to get a sense of mobile user behavior. When we look at the main shopping page, we can see the percentage of clicks to each of the links. Check if the page contains intuitive navigation. Given common site search queries, like shirts and YouTube, does the page content and navigation satisfy the user intent? Does a person looking for a Google shirt know to click wearables? If YouTube merchandise is extremely popular with my visitors, should the logo be included with the main category navigation in the center, or remain off to the right? And speaking of popular, we can use data to support that term. Looking at pages within Google Analytics, segmented by mobile traffic, we have a list of the popular pages for mobile visitors, the average time on page, bounce rate, and exits. The five most popular pages by views seems to confirm a few of the site search keywords. Google Store's visitors are interested in t-shirts and YouTube merchandise. Our understanding of mobile intent becomes more clear when we investigate web search queries in Google Webmaster Tools. Select your verified mobile site, navigate to search queries, and within top queries, select a date range of up to 3 months. With filters, we'll look at only the searches from mobile phones. To make sense of the data, as we discussed earlier, we may want to categorize queries. The first listed Google Store query variations are navigational queries. They require more research to understand intent. The third query, YouTube, is too broad to bring us qualified traffic, so we'll disregard it. The last five queries are likely transactional with intent to buy products from the Google Store. Let's further investigate the navigational Google Store queries to see if we can get an idea of why mobile searchers want the homepage. This may be especially useful since we already noticed our homepage has over 50% drop-off. Still in the Search Queries feature, filter queries containing Google Store and keep the search restricted to mobile. The filtered results show geo-based intent to find country-specific homepages. Clicking on the query, Google Store UK, displays that the page served in search results is still the general Google Store homepage at www.googlestore.com. This is clicked over 40% of the time, even though the Google Store has a specific UK homepage at google-store.com. A question to ask is, do searchers intend to find their location's country-specific page, or are they desiring to find a page outside their location? To figure this out, I'll filter the queries by Google Store UK on mobile, with the location limited to the United Kingdom. The results show the same number of impressions as we saw without the country restrict. We can conclude that searchers seem to desire their location's country-specific homepage. In that case, perhaps we can use GPS to personalize their on-site experience and show them country-specific content, but keep the tourist experience still available. You can use this type of approach, first categorizing queries, and then investigating more detail with filters, top pages, average rank, and CTR to further understand mobile user intent. So far, we've looked mainly at readily available numbers, but if you have the time, another great way to understand mobile user intent is to ask visitors themselves. Conduct mobile user studies or create mobile surveys. Just be sure the surveys are optional, not a pop-up window that interrupts the user's workflow. Judging from the data we've gathered, let's assume that one of the top tasks for the Google Store is a user who wants to buy a Google t-shirt. From our research, we also know some of the user's common unstated expectations. For example, if a user intends to buy a Google t-shirt, they also want the information relevant to them, likely listing their currency and available shipping. This became more evident through country-specific homepage queries. And the user probably wants to buy a Google t-shirt with a fast user experience. This is evident from mobile industry statistics as well as the Google Store's high percentage of drop-off. Visitors are willing to leave before they've even seen our products. Now that we've established more knowledge of the user intent, the second section of the video deals with refining mobile metrics. Although at present, mobile metrics show lower conversion than desktop, it's clear that mobile research influences purchasing decisions. In a Google Nielsen study, 93% of people who used mobile to research go on to make a purchase. When refining mobile metrics, it's helpful to differentiate desktop-initiated purchasing behaviors with smartphone-involved purchasing. Their traditional desktop models include desktop research to desktop purchase, or desktop research to in-store purchase, or desktop research to in-store research to desktop purchase. Smartphone involvement in purchasing can look a little different. There's mobile research to mobile purchase, mobile research to in-store purchase, cross-device conversion, like mobile research to desktop or tablet purchase, or even additional possibilities like in-store research, mobile price comparison, and then in-store at a competitor to finally make the purchase. Given mobile's diverse involvement in the purchase journey, many find it useful to track microconversions. Within your company, you can report these microconversions alongside the desktop macroconversions. They may include when mobile visitors locate a store, call the store, click the map for directions, share, save, add to wishlist, add to cart. It's reassuring to note that Adidas, with iProspect, found that 20% of mobile users who clicked on store locator links visited a store. If possible, also track cross-device workflow with logged-in users. The main takeaway for this second section is that because mobile behavior and intent can differ from desktop, rather than blindly reuse desktop metrics for mobile, instead, look at mobile task completion and follow mobile behaviors step by step as a contribution to conversion. For instance, if a user wants to research and buy a product, like a Google T-shirt, we could include mobile metrics of engagement, counting microconversions like pages per visit, add to cart, etc., rather than just orders, as we might do for desktop. Or if a common mobile task is to obtain a business's phone number, the metric can be measured by clicks on the phone number. Or take the mobile task to find in-store discounts when shopping. On mobile, the conversion may be barcode scans rather than printing or downloading coupons. The last section for optimizing mobile tasks is to use all of the information thus far to make improvements to user workflow. To start, actually run through a top mobile task for your site using the same types of devices as your users. The task we selected for the Google Store is to buy a Google T-shirt. Judging from the data in search queries, our mobile user may take two common approaches. They may perform a navigational query for Google Store or a transactional query for Google T-shirt. In either case, we can start to outline the workflow and take note of each step. In the search query and appearance stage, we can make sure that our site's appearance and search results is appealing. The page has a descriptive title and meta description. Once the user, let's pretend his name is Tom, selects our page and search results, we're in the page content and engagement stage. In the workflow with the query Google Store, once Tom clicks the search result, he comes to our homepage, where he must select his region. Then he's taken to his region's main shopping page, where he may select the wearables category with the subcategory men's t-shirts. Once at the men's t-shirt category page, hopefully Tom will click through to an individual product page where we can add to cart and eventually get to the conversion stage and make a purchase. By the end, Tom has both completed his task and helped our business. Thanks, Tom. Most real users' workflow has many more twists and turns than this. Still, it's useful to put yourself in your user's shoes, like Tom's, to get a sense of what it takes for task completion. Now, to prioritize improvements in the workflow, first, eliminate any unnecessary pages. Check for extraneous steps that can be merged or removed in both the site engagement and the conversion stage. Second, maintain information sent. Third, fix the remaining pages in the workflow that show poor user experience metrics. Fourth, minimize user interaction cost throughout the task. That's interactions such as typing, clicks, expands, and scrolls, which are particularly tedious and error-prone on smartphones. With the first action, reducing the number of pages required in the workflow, I can test removing the homepage map and displaying, based on the user, the appropriate main shopping page. This may also help reduce the over 50% homepage drop-off we saw earlier. We just need to make sure to provide that tourist experience. To maintain information sent, we'll strive to make the navigation and the calls to action intuitive. Remember the questions we asked while researching the mobile user's intent? Now it's time to test those ideas. Since the top query term in on-site search was shirt, that may mean that users either didn't notice or didn't associate the category wearables with t-shirts. That could signal a loss of information sent. We could test whether wearables is a helpful category name for t-shirts, and whether moving the category to one of the earlier options in the list increases microconversions for this task. Fixing pages with poor user experience metrics was actually filmed as a separate video. If you are unable to watch it, areas to focus for improvement are performance, usability, and content. Once that's complete, look to minimize the interaction cost required for completion. In other words, create a workflow that reduces typing. Perhaps use autocomplete, previously entered values, or auto-advancing fields. To simplify checkout, you can offer third-party checkout options. One click to delete pre-populated values also saves interaction cost, rather than requiring the user to repeatedly hit delete for each character. And while in delete mode, fully clear the input field. We found this issue as we audited the Google Store workflow. When trying to add to cart, the item count keeps a zero displayed even though it should be clear. This can make users feel they have to delete the phantom number. Or if they add one item, the number will append and make 10. It's easy to become overfamiliar with your site, so definitely check the first-time user experience and have new users perform common tasks. You may learn to improve usability with things like password in clear text option for users having trouble logging in, as well as errors that are clearly highlighted and auto-focused for faster correction. And with that, we've concluded the third and final section for optimizing the top mobile tasks on your site. It's my hope that you now feel more empowered to make improvements. Thanks for watching.